Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. You're all very welcome into Construction House. I think this is probably going to be our last breakfast briefing of 2014. And on reflection with a few people, I reckon we're in a slightly better place than we were this time last year. And hopefully, give us another 12 months, please God, we'll be in a better place again. And I'm delighted to welcome our president, who's probably coming towards the end of his term and one of his last. But we're very honoured that you've come this morning. Obviously, it's a sign you're going to be back in the game fairly quickly, Philip, I'd say. This morning, we're I suppose it's timely in that on Thursday, we're in the Department of Finance with the other stakeholders and Minister Simon Harris, following up on our submission, read the review of the government formal contract, and it's been a bone of contention and something that we've had issue with for a long time. The review is dragging on a lot longer than we would wish, but having said that, we believe that we're making progress and there will be some positives coming out this week and into the future. So in the light of that, I suppose there's been a lot of discussion, and I remember former director of main contracting, Donna Sullivan, used to get quite annoyed when he'd be going around meetings and people just tell him, oh, there's a much better form of contract wherever, whether it was in Hong Kong or in London or in Paris or wherever, and you know, we should be using that. Don had them all researched fairly well, and he eventually, I think, gave up sort of arguing the toss with people and just said, there probably is, you know, and we should do that. But rather than sort of curse the darkness or wish whatever else, we've decided to bring in sort of a superb expert on other forms of contract, James Golden, who is going to discuss both FIDIC, the NEC and JCT. He has fairly global experience of how they operate, the pros and cons and so on. So, you know, I think it's going to be an interesting presentation and maybe expel some of the myths that are out there, and maybe not, and maybe even in terms of the review, there's probably bits and pieces that we can include in our own form. James is dual qualified. He's an engineer and a barrister. He's not practicing that particular trait, but he's a director of Quick Golden, and that's a company that we have a lot of connection with here. He's a fairly regular contributor within the CIF, and I know a lot of our members use him as well. He lectures extensively on contract law and is a specialist on the NEC contract, and he regularly provides training both to public and private organisations, including Construction Excellence and the RICS. So we look forward to your presentation, James. As is usual, as soon as James is finished, we'll be open for Q&A, and it's probably the cheapest bit of advice you'll get from James this morning, any of it. There's no charge for answering any of his questions today. Otherwise, you might find a different story. So, James, we're delighted that you took time out to come in, and we're looking forward to your presentation.
Thanks, Tom. One of the fundamentals of any contract, any construction contract, is making sure you've got a clear grip on the specification, and it's not unusual for problems to arise whenever that misunderstanding of the specification gets to any serious extent. Martin Lang asked me back in October if I knew anything about you know, international contracts or British contracts, and I admitted that I did, since a lot of our work's in the UK. And he said, you wouldn't come in and talk to me about them, and I agreed that I would. And he said, I might bring a couple of other people along. So thanks for that, Mark. 45 minutes to explain JCT, FIDIC, and the NEC form of contract is a reasonably tall order. What I'm going to do is just give you pretty much an overview, and then we'll take whatever questions we have and see what it is that's on your mind, because I think that's probably the most efficient way to get through things. First of all, a little bit on Quick Golden and who we are and what we do. I know a number of you in the room here. First of all, a big part of the reason that we have such a warm relationship with the CIF is that so many people who are Irish contractors have been working in England for so long. We work both here in the Republic of Ireland. I'm from Northern Ireland. We have an office in Belfast, And we have an office in England as well, which is a thriving office. And at least half of my work is to do with English contracts or English forms of contract, most usually with Irish contractors. So as an adjudicator, I'm a practicing adjudicator in the UK. A lot of the disputes that I see turn on these forms of contract as well. So the direct experience that we have being an Irish firm in England helps a lot. Obviously here we do an awful lot on the PwC. The days of the RAEI and the IEI forms of contract seem in a distant memory now. The vast majority of the work here has been procured under the PwC for the past number of years. In the UK, it's all about either the NEC or the JCT forms of contract. The ICE form of contract is the old engineering form, which we still see some of. And then FITIC, the international form of contract, which we see a lot of actually in Ireland in various guises. And a lot of internationally, we do a lot of work in the Middle East, and FITIC is the form of contract over there. So what I do with these contracts is I represent parties in them. I represent people in arbitration, in adjudications in the UK, here on conciliations and mediations, and in litigation support as well. So I tend to see the worst of the contracts. I also, because I'm involved as a civil engineer, both with the IEI and with the Institution of Civil Engineers, I'm also involved in the policies behind contract introduction. And I've been heavily involved in the introduction and use of the NEC, particularly in Northern Ireland, and how that has been rolled out. So as well as the specifics of the dispute resolution stuff that we do, we tend to see the bigger picture. And on the procurement advice side of the business, we advise clients on what is the right contract to use and under what circumstances is the right contract to use. Not all clients. First instruction is how do we shaft the contractor. Some of them are actually fairly balanced about it, although perhaps not all. Busy year in Irish construction, so I'm aware that the PwC review is coming out. There is a Construction Contracts Act which is in suspended animation. A lot of press reports about how there's going to be growth in Irish construction, how everything looks rosy for 2015. Although not, I understand from recent press reports in sunny Northern Ireland, so there could be more of us with Northern accents heading south over the coming years, which I'm sure you'll all welcome. There's been a lot of change in regulations here. There's the building control regulations coming in. There's the Surrey registration scheme, which has had such a big effect on the CIF. So there's a lot happening in Ireland as well. But there still continues to be a significant interest in UK work from Irish contractors. And a lot of the questions that we get here that are based around other forms of contract tend to be because people are doing work in the north or across the water. Having said that, here, one of the obvious signs of the green shoots of growth is that we start to see more private sector contracts. We start to see more use of other forms of contract, the NEC, FITIC, indigenously here in Ireland, even a resurgence with the RAEI form. So there's a domestic need to understand how these contracts operate. So what I was asked to do was talk about FITIC, JCT and the NEC, how these contracts operate from a practical construction perspective, who the primary parties are, how that operates and what their impact might be on the Irish construction industry. So hopefully that's what we'll get through. A bit of a run through on what are the types of contract, just to make sure we're all speaking the same language. There is no contract that is a fix-all. There is no magic wand that will create construction in heaven. And what we're faced with is a spectrum of desire by clients to pass a greater or lesser risk to contractors. Most informed employers understand that they have to balance three things, which is cost, quality and time. And any construction contract is designed to balance cost, quality and time. And in the spectrum of contracts that I've put out there, the cost plus version is the version that provides the greatest certainty in terms of quality, or at least that's the intention. It provides the greatest certainty in terms of quality and often in terms of time, because cost, money is no object. It is perhaps another way of putting it, or perhaps with constraints on it. We don't see a lot of cost plus contracting here. I often, when I say that cost plus contracting is relatively common across the water, people laugh. But it is true. The Olympics was delivered on a cost plus basis. Crossrail, the massive infrastructure projects in London, are being delivered on a cost plus basis. And I'll come back to this. The NEC has a cost plus option, and NEC option E, which is just a straight cost plus, which is used as the primary tool for delivering Crossrail. And I, in 2014, have been involved in resolving a dispute on a cost plus contract. And you need to be working pretty hard to fall out with somebody if you're going to fall out with them on a cost plus contract, but it does happen. So next up would be a remeasurable contract where you're reimbursed for the quantities that you do. So a standard engineering contract which is remeasurable is probably next up. The contractor, you as a contractor, provide rates, and the idea is that you're not taking the risk of the quantities involved. And that's sort of the next step up in the level of pressure on contractors. Next up is lump sum contracting, which is what we're used to here. The PwC contracts are all lump sum contracts of one form or another, even if the compensation event process allows for revision because of changed quantities. They start off as being lump sum. And a lump sum contract will obviously put more pressure on a contractor to perform to the drawings and spec. Next up, D&B, so the passing of design risk to contractors and the extent to which a design risk is passed is the next tier of passing, of offloading risk from a client. But beyond that, you get turnkey contracts, so you get contracts where all of the risk is passed to the contractor. He's given a site, and the concept is that he comes back whatever many months or years later and hands over a set of keys and gets paid lump sums along the way. And finally, we see DBO contracts. We see contracts which are either through a PPP or PFI system, but where it's not just about the contractor building the job and walking away. He stays and operates it, and essentially the building project is only a component of the overall contract. So a big spectrum. And within that spectrum, there are lots and lots of different ways to dice the cake. Let's look at just some of the specific issues, because a lot of the practicality of this is, you know, well, what does it really mean for me? What are the specific issues? So I'm going to run through these four points, because a lot of the distinguishing features of contracts from a practical point of view tend to fall in to how one of these four things is dealt with. The first thing is what I've called the administrative risk. And what I mean by the administrative risk is the need for you as contractors to be on the ball, to produce notices and to produce claims by tight timeframes, or to lose your entitlement. That's a massive feature of the public works contracts. As contractors, you have been required to build a claims machine because the contracts require that. They need you to get these claims in or you lose all of your entitlement. And that's an administrative risk. It's not about the substance of the contract. It's not about whether it's cost plus or anything else. It's purely the need for you to be able to administer your own internal affairs rather than the construction of the job that drives the risk for you. The second thing is how we deal with the unknown, and particularly how a contract deals with unforeseen physical conditions. Now, that's a massive issue in civil engineering, but it's really a big issue for any kind of project that is in the ground or involves refurbishment, and an awful lot of them do. And there is an ongoing desire to move that risk from the client to the contractor, for better or for worse. And one of the crucial debates is in identifying how any of the contracts that I'm going to talk about operate is whether or not they're amended to remove the risk of unforeseen physical conditions from the employer. And I am sure a solid one-third all the disputes that we see are to do with amendments, and most of those are to do with unforeseen physical conditions. One of the things that has come up recently in Ireland about this is that clients now are getting the picture that for the past 6 or 7 years, they've been able to offload all sorts of risks to contractors, which you've accepted because actually they've had no option. Now they're getting the point that people are pricing or refusing to tender for contracts where there's an unreasonable risk of unforeseen physical conditions becoming a problem. And indeed, a lot of the insolvency issues that we've seen over the past 6 or 7 years have been driven by particularly the unforeseen physical condition risk being handed to a contractor, him having to accept it because of the state of the market. He's spreading his bets, he's just hoping that it doesn't come up, and when it does, it knocks him down. And that's caused a lot of problems for clients, but hasn't been particularly good for the contractor involved either. The next point is about nomination and novation. It's about how design operates. To some extent, it's still about how specialist contractors are dealt with, but more particularly, it's about how the client can design the works himself, have it designed by his designer, and then force you as the contractors to take that risk by novating the design team to you. And again, one of the points with all of the standard forms is that they don't anticipate this. They don't see this ever happening, and yet it happens a lot. It certainly happens a lot in contracts in which I'm involved, possibly because they're the ones that end up in dispute. So the client's desire to both be able to control the design through their own designer, but pass the risk to you as contractor, is tied up with that process and how that novation works. And of all of the things on that list that is about clients trying to have their cake and eat it, the novation process that we see is definitely the main one. So that remains an ongoing specific issue. The next thing, which is the endemic problem with any construction contract, particularly any that's going to end up as a problem, is poor quality contract documents. The poor quality of the drawings and specifications, the poor quality of how the risks that are thought through at the executive rather than the strategic level in a client organisation are dealt with. So the cock-ups that are made by the architect or the quantity surveyors or by the engineers that design the works and do the build. And that's not fixed by any contract. If a client does not make sure that they put together the contract documents correctly, then the contract documents will end up creating real difficulties. And the question for you is, which of these contracts protects you best from that problem, from the problem of the client's team just not doing their job properly? That's a bit of a mute point. Certainly the public works contracts pass a lot of that risk to you. And really it's tied up with the administrative risk where you're being asked to bear some sort of obligation, or you're being restricted from being able to recover for mistakes that are just not yours. Ambiguity in documents, how you deal with priorities of documents, how you deal with the inconsistencies in having to price a bill of quantities which does not reflect the actual quantities in the job. All of those things fall in the category of poor contract documents. And they're not fixed by any standard form. The thing that's not on the list then, that the last point about sort of things that don't go away, is what happens whenever your competitors are cutting their own throats. And to what extent are you protected if it's a normally low tender. The The other way of looking at that is which one of these contracts allows you best to create claims that means you can recover from a bad deal. None of them are designed to do that, unsurprisingly. All of them are designed to force you to stand by the price that you made. But some of them are more prone to tendermanship and to claims development than others. They tend to be the ones that are perhaps less transparent, and that's something I'll comment on as I go through them. Okay. Right. So then, just the reason that we have standard forms of contract, stating the obvious, we have standard forms of contract for a consistent and well understood contractual approach. The reason that we have standard forms of contract is so that everyone understands how you're going to do your business without having always to read the small print. That's the point. And even though you might not like a standard form, at least if you always understand how it operates, then you can start to get used to that. Because although the construction industry, and I'm sure everyone in this room, runs organisations that are very nimble and very flexible from a work point of view, it's actually quite difficult to develop a contractual approach which changes. You'll want a contractual approach that allows your team, your administrative team, often your quantity surveyors, your commercial team, to have a sensible, practical, routine approach so that your administration happens consistently. And that's what a standard form is supposed to do. Therefore, beware of things that will wreck that for you. Now, the one point that falls out of that, which I'll come back to, is that actually having standard forms of contract in Ireland, even ones as brutal as the public works contracts, means that you can develop a standard approach. If the only work that you do is PwC work, well then you'll gear up to PwC contracts or die. I'm assuming you're still here, then you'll have geared up for it. And so you have a machine that works with those contracts, and your tendering will be more efficient, your contract administration will be more efficient, so beware of change. Particularly, beware of amendments. Those of you that are used to working in the PwC environment, you do not see amendments. You can turn to Schedule 1K, you can see what's ticked yes or no, and you'll know what form of contract that is. Other forms of contract and other contracts in other jurisdictions can often be heavily amended, and those amendments run from being just purely superficial to amending very substantial elements of the contract, and that's difficult to cope with. So beware of amendments. And lastly, beware of incompetence. Beware of incompetent administration. There's nothing, no matter how good a contract is, no matter how good the policy is behind it, if the people operating it, particularly the contract administrators that operate these contracts, the architects, the engineers, the project managers in the NEC, the employers' representatives in the PwC, if they are not competent, then you will have a problem. You will suffer, almost certainly. And there's opportunities with any risk, but by and large, it brings pain. So beware of the incompetent administrator on the other side. Okay, fine, right. So first of all then, the forms that I was asked to look at. FIDIC. FIDIC is the French, the acronym for the French name for the Federation of International Consulting Engineers. It's been around for a very, very long time. Its genesis, where it comes from, is the engineering forms of contract, the old ICE forms of contract, the IEI 4th edition that you might have been used to in civil engineering, is the place that FIDIC came from 30 or 40 years ago. Nowadays, it's a rainbow nation of contracts, running from the traditional Red Book, which is the closest thing to the old IEI form of contract that you'll see in the international marketplace, or indeed now, it includes a short form, The yellow form, the design and build form, is extremely common, particularly here. The silver book, the design and build turnkey version of the contract, is relatively common. The ESB use it for a lot of their projects. It's used for a lot of large infrastructure projects internationally. There's a gold form for design, build, operate, where FIT have got on the bandwagon of the DBO system. And there's even a pink form for multilateral development banks, so systems of financing, which I must say I'm not directly, never been directly involved in. So the FIDIC form of contract comes as a suite as well. It's not, when people say FIDIC, they usually mean the red book, but not necessarily. And so you do need to be clear which one it is. Just a couple of points on it. It's the most widely used contract in the world. FIDIC is the contract that is used by the World Bank for any infrastructure that it funds. And very often, if you see infrastructure projects in Europe being funded by, being contracted on FIDIC, it's because there's a World Bank involvement, because the World Bank will require the use of FIDIC, in much the same way as the Department of Finance here will require the use of the PwC. So it's extremely widely used internationally. It's got what I describe as a traditional balanced risk associated with it. It is a genuine standard form in that it is developed by an organisation that doesn't have an axe to grind either with contractors or with the client. It's a genuine standard form, which probably the PwC couldn't be categorised as. It's a creature from the government, from one side. It's not a negotiated contract, whereas FIDIC is. And the idea with that traditional balance is that it only pays extra if a risk comes up, and as a contractor, you don't have to price a risk that is difficult to assess. So it's designed to be balanced in that way. In terms of points to note about FIDIC, and I mean, I appreciate you're only going to get a snapshot of these in time, but I'm happy to come back and explore any of these points with you in questions. It's got this odd process of an engineer's determination. So the contract administrator in FIDIC, at least in the red and the yellow form, is the engineer. And the engineer makes a determination in accordance with clause 3.5, which is a bit of an odd provision because it requires the engineer to try to agree any differences with the contractor and the employer in the first step. So the modern FIDIC, the 1999 FIDIC, has this idea of the engineer being a bit of a mediator. And he should be a go-between between the employer and the contractor to try and reach agreement about issues where there's a difference. In the Red Book, Clause 12 is a remeasurement provision. So the Red Book of FIDIC is a remeasurable contract. Whatever the quantities are, you get paid on the rates. It's remeasurable. The variation procedure in Clause 13.3 is a traditionally familiar procedure. It's bill rates, adjusted bill rates, or fair valuation for the valuation of variations. And the contract includes rights to claim additional cost if there's delay, and an extension of time claim, a wrapped up extension of time claim for various events. So not the discrete claim based on each individual compensation event that you'll see from the PwC. It includes a required claims procedure, so something equivalent to Clause 10.3 under the PwC at Clause 20.1. And the only condition precedent in FIDIC is in Clause 20.1, where you as a contractor have to get your claims notification in within 28 days of becoming aware of the event. That's the only condition precedent. So it still exists. There is an administrative risk in dealing with FIDIC, but it is a good deal less than the PwC, because the PwC is by far the school of hard knocks in terms of construction contracts. And then dispute resolution in FIDIC is through, in the first instance, through a dispute adjudication board, a DAB, which is actually a pretty onerous first stage of dispute resolution. It's a three-man panel that's constituted to look at disputes. And it takes a force of will to want to bring a dispute to a DAB. You wouldn't run off to a DAB in the same way, and I'm not sure many do, but you might run off to conciliation or adjudication in the UK, where you would dispute something through the dispute resolution system relatively handily, because the DAB and the constitution of the DAB is pretty bureaucratic. But it's designed to give an interim decision in the same way as adjudication would in the UK. So that's the FIDIC, well-balanced and sensible contract. Now, it does have, particularly in the Silver Book, the understanding that there will be particular conditions. And you see particular conditions in the yellow form, anticipated by the yellow form as well. And frequently those particular conditions are used to amend the contract. They're not just to embellish it or to talk about things that you might expect to be there, but they actually are used to amend the core clauses. And that can dramatically rebalance the risk. Like, for instance, removing clause 412, which is the unforeseen physical conditions clause. Particular conditions are frequently introduced to do that. So you need to be aware of that. But otherwise, a standard form FIDIC contract, perfectly sensible thing. Right, next up is JCT. This is the contract produced by the Joint Contracts Tribunal in the UK. It is the standard UK building contract. It comes in a whole plethora of different options now. There's a JCT contract for virtually anything. There's even a JCT partnering contract. excuse me. So you have the intermediate form and the minor works forms for smaller works, as well as the standard building contract. But the standard building contract is the usual contract for FIDIC, for JCT. And whenever we talk about a JCT, what most people mean is the standard building contract, either with or without quantities, in exactly the same way as the RIAI came in its yellow and blue forms. The JCT came from the RIBA forms of contract. It came from the same maternity ward as the RIAI form did here. And when you look back over, the JCT 68 versions, JCT 64 versions and all the rest of it, they're very, very similar to old versions of the RIAI. And then gradually the RIAI went in one direction and JCT went in another. And at the moment it's JCT 2011, the most up-to-date version. There is JCT 2005, JCT 98 still out there. And the JCT has not revolutionized its approach ever. All of the contracts are evolutions, not revolutions of what went before. So if you're used to an RIAI approach, you'll find the JCT approach very familiar. It's the most used contract in the UK. It is the contract that you are most likely to bump into in the United Kingdom. It's got a traditional division of risk. So it's a traditional contract in the way the RIA is, although it has been modernized. So you've got an architect or contract administrator. There is a place for introducing the concept of a quantity surveyor and giving him a role in valuing the works. So it's very much what I grew up with in terms of what was the way of doing building works. The RIAI form here, or in Great Britain, it would be JCT. The contract administrator is in charge. It's got a system for loss and expense claims. You get paid variations through bill rates. All of that sort of stuff comes from JCT and has not changed. It is a very complex contract. It runs to something like 70,000 words, where the PwC is more like 30,000 and the NEC more like 15,000. So it's hard to read. You don't sit down and read the JCT contract. You study it. It's more like the Torah than the Gospels. So it's in relatively impenetrable if you're not used to it. But it is highly structured. from a lawyer's point of view, I find it much easier to understand than a lot of the other contracts where there's woolly edges, where there's undefined terms. And particularly when we come on to talk about the NEC, there's a legal risk with the NEC because it's drafted in such an easygoing way so that it's more accessible to practitioners. People are actually building the works, but perhaps less precise when it comes to time to fall out about things. So the JCT succeeds there because it is so highly structured. What do you need to note about it? Well, the change management process, which is always close to our hearts, based on bill rates, which we're familiar with or still familiar with provisional sums, and a loss and expense and extension of time claim. So the JCT contract comes with change paid for either through the contract which you've got, amended to suit amendments, all the rest of it. If it's a lump sum contract, there will usually be provisional sums, which will allow remeasurement, particularly of ground conditions, something like that, which spreads the risk. And it's got the traditional loss and expense and extension of time claim that claims consultants love. It has all the hallmarks of a contract that, and of all of the contracts that I'm describing today, the one most readily accused of favouring tendermanship is JCT, because that's where the whole concept came into existence, dealing with the intricacies of JCT and how it operates, and particularly how loss and wrapped up loss and expense and extensions of time claim can be used. The different individual forms of the JCT describe the risk split accurately. That's important because most of the other standard forms, the NEC, FIDIC, and the public works contracts here, the contractor design element of it can sneak in. It can look like it's an employer design contract, but there can be elements of contractor design which are in the original tender documents and can be increased during the life of the contract. So there can be sneaky contractor design. In the JCT, if there is not a contractor design supplement, or if it is not the design and build form, then you as contractor are not responsible for design at all, even if you produce the design. So again, it's a more contractor-friendly environment in terms of that design risk. It has the concept of on account and final account payments. So you get paid as you go along for change, even if the change has not been finally decided. So there's unlike particularly the lump sum versions of the NEC or even the public works contracts, where you don't get your money for change until the change is sorted out. With the JCT, the contract administrator has a proper mechanism to pay money on account with the understanding that it'll all be resolved in a final account at the end. And the final account process is derided by many as meaning that you put off the evil day and everybody ends up in a big row at the end. But the practicality of it is often found to be quite positive in that you don't have to worry about fighting about things during the currency of the contract, and there's a proper way to wash it all up at the end in the final account, which is often a pretty convenient way of doing what we would tend to do as human beings anyway. Let's just see how the dust settles and then we'll do the deal at the end. That's the JCT way. That's how JCT approaches things. The standard form JCT incorporates UK adjudication as a dispute resolution mechanism, even if it's not in the UK. But having said that, I have never met a JCT contract outside of the United Kingdom. So if it's in Ireland, let me know, because I'd be quite interested why they didn't use the RIAI. If it's in the UK, then all it does is use the statutory adjudication process with all of the pros and cons of statutory adjudication that have been kicked around here for the past 4 or 5 years as we've talked about the Construction Contracts Act. A rapid, brutal, not inexpensive way of resolving disputes is the JCT way. Fine. Okay. Next up then is the NEC. The NEC new engineering form of contract. This comes as a whole suite of contracts as well. It is the It is extremely popular in the UK. It is extremely, extremely popular in Northern Ireland. And it comes in many guises. And it's the guise that matters. It's the main option that matters. So the ECC is the engineering construction contract. That's the main contract form. And it comes in six, but the ones that matter are five different versions. There's an option A, which is a lump sum contract, B, remeasurable, C and D, which are target cost, D being remeasurable, C, a lump sum target, and E, straight cost reimbursable. There are subcontracts, there's short contracts, there's short subcontracts, there's an adjudicator contract, there's professional services short contracts, term service contracts, all sorts. The idea with the NEC, the concept with the NEC, is that it will cover absolutely every part of the construction chain. And if you get into an NEC contract, you're encouraged, as a main contractor, you're encouraged to adopt an NEC subcontract and have your subcontractors do the same and all the rest of it. And that's the idea. Whether or not it's a good idea or not, it is rather more debatable, but that's the concept. The concept is the entire project from one side to the other can be NEC, and therefore everybody's speaking the same language, and it just fits together properly. It is the most by value construction in the UK is procured through the NEC, because all of the big infrastructure projects are NEC projects in the UK. As I mentioned, the Olympics are built through the NEC, the Crossrail project is NEC, a lot of the big rail developments that are forecast for England are going to be NEC, the highways use the NEC, so it's used for big value projects. It's also now used for much smaller value projects, and it's quite common to see NEC contracts being let for under £1 million. It is embedded in the British construction market. It's designed to be a partnering contract. It is lauded as being a partnering contract, the contract that delivers value because everybody works together. And I actually find that slightly annoying. We built the whole country based on contracts where we partnered with each other. We worked together to build all of the infrastructure that you can see around you. And we might have fallen out about bits and pieces, but the construction industry is obviously about partnering. And just to put a label on a contract, to try and say that other contracts mean you don't, I find slightly irksome, but there you go. Part of the upside of the partnering contract concept is that it is at least designed that it will be a better working environment. So the first clause in the NEC says the parties shall work in accordance with a contract and in a spirit of mutual trust and cooperation. It's an express term in the contract. What mutual trust and cooperation actually means in reality, though, it is rather flexible. NEC contracts, when they work, are brilliant, and I mean this, they are absolutely brilliant. The project management side of Quigg Goldman's business, which is all private sector clients, we use the NEC option A with contractor design as the standard contract, and it is absolutely brilliant. Everybody working together, everybody engaged, following the processes that the contract includes, it works brilliantly. The problem is that when the wheels fall off, there's a real problem. The JCT is maybe characterised as a bit of a tractor, which doesn't get you terribly fast from one place to the other. Whereas the NEC is a train, which gets lots of people from one place to the other until somebody breaks the tracks, and then nobody goes anywhere. And that's not a bad analogy. If the NEC contract doesn't work, then it can be very, very difficult to untangle. Most of my adjudication practice is on the NEC contract, because when people fall out, then they fall out in a big way. The change management system has all sorts of odd things that we would be perhaps unused to here. Particularly, it's got a system about early warning and risk review, which forces the parties to work together and attempt to cooperate to remove risks and to reduce risks, which when it works, it's absolutely brilliant, and when it doesn't, it's very bad, or at least sometimes worse than useless because it confuses the situation. But when it works, it's first class. It's also got this concept of accepted programme. The NEC has a ferocious programming burden on contractors. Not dissimilar from how the PwC requires you to programme your works, but probably more so. And one of the upshots of that is that it strips contractors bare. It forces contractors to reveal how they intend to build the job, warts and all. And the NEC contract is lauded as being a contract that actively prevents tendermanship, actively prevents contractors from recovering from a bad deal, because the programming system, if it's worked properly, forces contractors to reveal where the gaps are in their tender, and so makes it much, much more difficult for contractors to recover from a normally low tender or from an underbidding situation, which is obviously completely academic for anyone in the CIF, because you never would underbid projects, so it's therefore pointless, and I'll move on. Some points to note. The first thing about the NEC is that it is very, very often amended. The NEC is built up of main and secondary options. And one of the secondary options is option Z. Z clauses are designed to allow the contract to cope with particular additional clauses. The public sector organisations will want an additional clause in to deal with, you know, freedom of information requests or anti-corruption provisions. But what option Z is usually or very often used for is to create amendments which dramatically change the risk split in the contract. And there are horror stories of how often the NEC is amended and in what way. And the whole concept of partnering and the idea that it is a standard form at all is very often undermined by the changes in that are imposed on the contract. So if you're faced with an NEC contract, the place to look first is to see what the Z clauses are, to see what the amendments are. The next point to note really is the project manager and his function. The concept of the NEC is light touch contract administration by the project manager. Many project managers don't get that. And very often project managers are overly or very enthusiastic about their duties to the detriment of contractors. I see that a lot in terms of the audit requirements. An aspect of partnering is the open book nature of the contracts. And project manager interference to make that audit process very invasive is quite common. So project manager interference and who the project manager is a big part of how an NEC contract will pan out. Many, many project managers are contract administrators, architects, engineers, QSs, from a JCT or other background and do not understand how the NEC operates. And that causes an awful lot of pain. Next up is the compensation event system. So the NEC compensation event system looks a bit like the PwC system. So it's got a defined list of events that for which you'll recover additional money. It doesn't have the same brutal conditions precedent. You've got 8 weeks to notify compensation events in the unamended form, and you don't have to notify them if they come from the instructions of the project manager. which is a good deal less than you would under the PwC. But the cost that you can recover can be difficult in two ways. First of all, it's all about proving the additional cost that a compensation event made you suffer. And that can be hard to do. Any of you that have in the past done loss and expense claims will perhaps understand that. Or if you've been forced to price compensation events under the PwC based on the change in cost, you can see how hard that is. And that's what is required in any event under the NEC. So it can be really difficult to prove that you're due your money in the face of a project manager who's intransigent about it. And there are some costs that are not covered. So if for example, and the next point there is about the flexibility of contractors' design, the NEC on the face of it allows the project manager to issue instructions passing what was an employer design contract to you, at least in part as contractor. And the compensation event mechanism gives you no way of recovering for example, increased PI insurance. If you have to go from none to lots, there's no way, no mechanism under the unamended NEC for you to be paid for that. And that can cause very real problems. In common with the JCT, the form of dispute resolution in the NEC is adjudication. And it's something shy of the standard UK version of adjudication, but it's where the concept of adjudication came from. So even in the international form, which is what you tend to see here in the NEC, where the adjudication option is a diluted version of what British adjudication is, it's still adjudication in that sense. It's a short, rapid, pretty brutal dispute resolution process. And it's embedded in the NEC form of contract. Okay, so that's the whistle-stop tour of FIDIC and the JCT and the NEC form of contract. And just finish up with a couple of conclusions before we take questions. One point which I have to make, because it's very obvious, is about the school of hard knocks. Irish contractors have been forced by the use of the public works contracts to sharpen up their contract administration in a way that your competitors across the water find unexpected. My own experience of Irish contractors of the past is that you've got a relatively laissez-faire approach to contract administration compared to your competitors across the water. And that has now changed dramatically. The public works contract, and if your systems are geared to work within the tight regime that is the public works contract, then any of the other forms of contract will seem like a cakewalk in comparison. They all have edges to them, but none of them are anything like the administrative burden or have anything like the administrative burden that the public works contracts here. So you've been to the school of hard knocks, and hopefully you're made stronger by it. The next thing is whether you'll pick the devil you know or you don't know. One of the advantages of the PwC here, and it's much like the use of the NEC in Northern Ireland, is that it's the only show in town. That if you're contracting, particularly in the public sector, the only contract there is the PwC, and you know what it's about. It's the devil you know. And it may not be a particularly pleasant place, but a virtue of how the public sector here have developed that contract is that it's used universally, and we are gradually getting to understand what it's about. Whereas in England, the huge number of different forms of standard form in quotes means that you're starting from a blank page virtually every time you tender, and an awful lot of contracting organisations really struggle to jump from JCT to FIDIC to NEC and back again, and to have, you know, one commercial office that's working with three or four very, very different commercial, commercially administered contracts causes all sorts of problems, all sorts of problems. So there is a real advantage to the devil, you know, or at least with us having a consistent approach to contracting. The only person in the room that will benefit from us having lots of different forms of standard form is me. And by and large, even though it's coming up to Christmas, most of you aren't that keen to do better for Quick Golden. So be very careful in encouraging clients to use something that you're not used to. And the last point is that most car crashes are because of the driver, not the car. The reason that there's a car crash in construction contracts is generally not because of the nature of the contract itself, but it's because of the person that's driving them. And very often that's the contract administrator. Very often that's the professional practice people that perhaps have bid for their work on an abnormally low tender, are doing it on a shoestring, are dealing with contracts that they weren't trained on, are finding themselves trying to carry out functions that they're unfamiliar with, and that causes you a world of pain. And that's as common under any of the standard forms that I've mentioned already. So be very careful thinking that the other standard forms are all good and not bad. These things, particularly how the contract documents are put together and who runs them, causes just as much difficulty as the problems that we see here do.